Good morning, live stream. Glad to have you with us this morning as well. Another Sunday of where thankfully the sun is shining because it is cold again, but hopefully it's going to be a little bit warmer by the time we get out of here later this morning. So I really only have one announcement that I can think of and remember for this morning, and it only really affects our board members. So I'm going to cancel the board meeting for this coming week. So I'll get back in touch with you about rescheduling that, but a couple of things that are in the way of us having it for this week. So for our board members, stay home and enjoy the evening. I don't think I've ever gotten a complaint about canceling a board meeting, so I don't think I will this week either. All right, we got a few more people coming in, but I'm going to go ahead and pray for us as our call of worship, and the worship team can start making their way up, and we'll get ready for some singing. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for today, and just for another opportunity to be able to be here together with you and with one another, both in person and through the technology. Father, draw us all close together. We're still struggling with these being distant from one another aspects that continue on, and we really just anxiously look forward to the day of some of these restrictions just disappearing, Father. And so in the meantime, give us perseverance to continue on and fill us with anticipation of being able to really fully embrace one another again. Father, this service is yours, and may your will be done this morning here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, again. Good morning, live stream. I'm just so thankful to see all of your beautiful faces, even on such a frigid morning. Friends, let's go before the Lord in worship. Our God covets our praise and our worship. So let's just give it to him full-heartedly this morning. So if you would stand with us, we're going to sing together.
Thank you.
is it that our God came to this world to give us abundant, full life? Can I get an amen on that, guys?
Amen.
Absolutely. Our God is here for us as we are here for him. So as we're singing together, I pray that my prayer for this next song is that we would just daily, even after we've heard messages again and again, we would come before God awed in who he is in the presence of his glory.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the
I can tell we've all had our coffee this morning. Yeah. Would you guys just pray with me before we go into this next one? Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for all that you are. Lord, I pray that no matter what is happening here in this service, Lord, we are your children and we are here to be in your presence. Lord, please bless us with your presence. We just pray, Lord, that as we're singing our final song, that you're also prepping Dennis's heart. Lord, I pray that as he's speaking, Lord, that you would speak through him beautifully so that we can hear your word, Lord, and learn from you. In the name of your son, we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that sings.
Thank you for the music this morning. That was wonderful. We were able to sing Amazing Grace at the service yesterday as well. I've been blessed both yesterday and today by that song. Our scripture reading for today is in Isaiah chapter 43. Kind of a long section today, 13 verses. I'm reading this today. This is directed towards Israel in the context. So I'm not trying to apply the context to us this morning by reading it. What I want us to hear is these descriptions about God and what is being said about God, and kind of pick up on some of these character aspects of our God. And so as I read it for us, and at the end of the section, you'll hear this statement, "You are my witnesses." And that's really a key statement for us for today, for our focus. So If you have it, you can follow along. If you want to just listen, that's great as well. If you are following along with another Bible, I'm reading from the ESV translation, and so you may have a different translation, which is fine, but some of the words and phrases may be a little bit different. So Isaiah 43, beginning in verse 1. "But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you, I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for your glory, whom I formed and made. Bring out the people who are blind yet have eyes, who are deaf yet have ears. All the nations gather together, and the peoples assemble. Who among them can declare this and show us the former things? Let them bring their witnesses to prove them right, and let them hear and say it is true. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I declared and saved and proclaimed when there was no strange God among you. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. Also, henceforth, I am he. There is none who can deliver from my hand. I work, and who can turn it back?" So there's Isaiah 43, and I hope that just kind of fills your imagination and gives you some things to think about as we continue to read and study different portions of God's Word. We're going to spend a few moments in prayer as we do each week. And as I pray for us today corporately, this is time for you to pray as well. We all have different things going on, good things, difficult things, sad things, hard things. No shortage of things to be praying for. So as I pray, pray as well and go before our God, and let's go before him in honesty and humility and thankfulness. I'm really thankful for the songs today. It really, I think, prepares us well for some prayer. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we just spend a few moments in the time of prayer, these beautiful songs that we sang today are just still going through my mind, Father, and I thank you for them. I thank you for inspiring artists and musicians and putting those together and blessing us with having the team willing to be here and to practice and to do everything that's necessary for these songs to fill not only this space, but to go through the live stream as well, and to be a blessing for those who are with us through the live stream. Father, that song, the indescribable, it just so many pictures just come to mind of you as you were creating. And of course, we don't know what it looked like, Father, but I just find myself in awe of thinking about you creating and forming the stars, and then as we just think about the planets that we know so well about, not only ours, but the system that we are part of, and of you forming and making a circle and an orbit, and just putting all of that together, and all of this spinning and turning and everything just coming from your goodness and your glory and your imagination and your creativity is truly stunning, Father. And just thinking about our human bodies and our blood veins and everything that's coursing through our bodies, just thinking about you forming us and almost being like just like a sower, a weaver, weaving and sewing our bodies together, and just the joy and the beauty and the amazing creation that you have given us, Father. It's truly a wonderful testament to who you are, and I praise you for it, and I thank you for it, Father. And I think of this song, this amazing song, Amazing Grace, that has lasted for so many generations, for centuries now at this point. It has been sung, and here recently it's been sung out over the land in which we live. And I pray that the message of that song will truly, truly get into our hearts and minds, Father, and that we will pay attention, and that we will listen, and that we will, as that phrase in Hebrews, consider Jesus, that we will consider your Son as Savior, and consider you as Father, and Holy Spirit as Counselor. Lord, it is still almost assuredly painfully evident of how incapable we are, of how frail and fragile we are, and of how much we are in need of you. Father, hold us and help us to behold you. Bless us and help us to glorify you. Thank you for these few brief moments that we get to spend together, Father. It is a gift, and help us to not waste this gift. Prepare us now for your word. May it be your word that is shared today, Father, and may your will be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Acts chapter 1 is where we're going to spend most of our time today. So if you want to start finding that, you're welcome to. Acts chapter 1 is in the New Testament, right after the book of John. You can start finding that. We'll get there here in a little bit. I do have a confession to make. Jeremy and I were here yesterday, and Jeremy said afterwards, you need to work a little bit on this sermon. So I'm sorry, Jeremy, I was not able to work on it, so here we go. Maybe hopefully it'll be a little bit better. All right, I'm just giving Jeremy a little bit of a hard time. While I'm thinking of it, people here on the live stream, you don't get to see what goes on Saturday here. Jeremy and Gail have put in a lot of work and do a lot for us to be able to have the Saturday service, and so I'm very thankful for Jeremy and Gail and their willingness. All right, so one of the great unifying things for us as humans, in my opinion anyway, is asking and answering questions. Now, questions can be both great and really frustrating, right? They can be a wonderful thing, they can be a really frustrating thing. There can be questions that are isolated to certain groups or situations, but I think there is one question that cuts through every boundary, whether it's age or culture or situation. And you're dying to know what the question is, right? Here's the question. What's that? That's the question. What's that? If you travel, you're going to ask that question, right? Parents ask this question of their children. Ooh, what's that? All right. Children ask this question of their parents, especially when it comes to food. What is that? All right. I imagine that Camp Berea staff probably asked that question quite a bit when cleaning out cabins, right? Ooh, what's that, right? Let's try to avoid that as much as we can, right? The question, what's that, with the answer, a Christian, is the hope of what we will answer in part today. Christianity can be a curiosity, and we only ask questions of it in order to satisfy our intellect. Well, what do you believe as Christians? Well, what are some of your traditions and so forth as Christians? It can be simply just to kind of learn more about Christianity. I contend, however, that Christianity is a here and now, all in, for always existence, that is for the glory of another, in which we follow and represent his will while we live here on earth. It's not cheap or easy. It is glorious. It is wonderful. It is what we are supposed to be. It is life-altering, direction changing, while we stay living in familiar surroundings. Being a Christian gives us liberty and freedom unmatched by anything else, and gives us a responsibility so overwhelming that it makes being in charge of the nuclear codes pale in comparison. In fact, it is so important, it hasn't been left to us alone to figure out. Someone has said, Christian life is an impossible journey without God's supernatural intervention. And I believe that's true. So, who are we in this impossibly possible, exquisite, ordinary life? We are in Christ, and we are his ambassadors and witnesses. We are in Christ, and we are his ambassadors and witnesses. I'm combining two topics today because they're quite similar. So we're going to just quickly glance at being ambassadors and then spend more time looking at being witnesses. Now, this concept of being an ambassador is in many different places throughout Scripture. There's some different words that are used and so forth, but the concept is similar. And I really appreciate this thought that I read this week. The gospel calls us to recognize that everything we have is a gift from God, and that those gifts are to be used for his glory and to further his kingdom. Scripture even calls Christians caretakers of God's gifts and truth. The author continued on to say, a steward is a person who has been entrusted with an other's resources and who seeks to manage those resources according to the owner's vision and values. An ambassador, a steward, takes care of this thing not according to their own will, but according to the will of the owner. Ambassadors represent the will of another. They do not seek satisfaction of their own will or desires. In one verse, it probably is familiar for many of us, in 2 Corinthians 5, Paul says this, "We are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God." So Paul just puts it real plainly, we are ambassadors for Christ. Now last week we quickly mentioned the significance of the biblical statement, the will of God, as part of our discussion. And that fits in this week as well, the will of God. This tells us that when we say God, we're not talking about an abstract, ethereal, malleable idea floating around up there somewhere. We're actually talking about a person, right? This is important because we're not talking about an institution which could have dozens or hundreds or thousands of persons with opinions about what the institution is, right? We're talking about a person. Now, a quick-minded person may say, but I thought the God of the Bible was a Trinity. Three in one. Three persons in one. And in fact, you would be right about that, of course. So here's something so beautiful and important for us to hold on to with that tricky, difficult truth of God being three in one. So we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They are each distinct persons, and they are one. When we read Scripture, what we find is that they are always consistent with each other. They are always going to be consistent with each other. You will never pit one against the other. There will never be a conversation. Just to pick one as an illustration, you will never, ever find any evidence of a conversation of Jesus going to the Holy Spirit and saying, Holy Spirit, can you believe God the Father said that? Can you believe Dad was saying that thing? Right? What are we going to do about this? Well, you talk to him. Oh, you talk to him. Right? They're never fighting with one another. This is incredible. This is astounding. They are also never competing with one another. Their will is consistent with each other. They are distinct. They are one. They're consistent. They're never competing. And that is beautiful and that is important. So when we deal with one, we know what the other two will think as well. You're familiar with this, right? Of we as humans pitting somebody against another to try to get what we want, right? You're never going to be able to do that. The Holy Spirit is a counselor here to help us. We use counselor in like a therapy sense a lot. That's not really the biblical idea, right? But we're never going to be able to go to the Holy Spirit and say, you know, hey, let's you and me discuss this thing about God the Father. Let's see if we can do something different. You're never going to win that argument, right? So as ambassadors, we represent the will of God. Quick picture to try and pull this out and just belabor the point. So here in Plymouth, we are blessed to have Plymouth State University, right? And the students are going to be coming back, semester starting back up again, so let's be praying for the faculty and staff and the students. Let's pray that they have a really good semester ahead of them here. But we as a church have a lot of connections with Plymouth State University in a lot of different ways, right? Now, what do you think would happen if I traveled to another state and began to represent myself as an ambassador of Plymouth State University, right? And I began to pass out enrollment forms. And I began to determine who was accepted. And I determined which bank accounts the tuition cost would be directed to. And how much the tuition would actually cost. Right. Now, Jeremy and I talked about this yesterday. He said very clearly, you cannot do this, right? And this is only an illustration, so no worries, I'm not going to do this, right? But let's just say that I did. I traveled, I told people, I can get you in to Plymouth State University for $10 a semester. Whoa! Really? Okay, sure. Right? What would happen to the unfortunate people who would pack up and they would come to Plymouth to move in at the beginning of the semester? And they would walk up and they would state their name and they'd say, we're here, we're excited, we're ready to go. And the people with the fancy tablet or clipboard or whatever it would be looking up a name and saying, sorry, your name is not here. And I'm looking at our system. Your name is nowhere in our system. We don't know what's going on. How is it that you got here? Well, we talked to Ambassador Simmons. And Ambassador Simmons said that I got accepted and I was welcome here at Plymouth State. And I checked my bank, the money got deposited. Sorry. We have no record of you in any way. Right? We're sorry, but you've been lied to. We have no Ambassador Simmons. We do not employ anyone in that role. You've been lied to. You've been tricked. Right? That's one way to look at it. Another way to look at it would be that I go to Plymouth State and I say, hey, I want to be an ambassador. And they foolishly say, okay. Right? And I go out and I'm talking to people and they say, well, hey, can I pay, you know, $500 for a semester? Like, oh, sure. Right? I would have some pretty serious meetings when I got back. Right? Because they would say, you are determining things that you have no right to determine. That tuition cost is not our will. Oh, okay. Right? Do you see it, right? I'm really pushing it here, but in the hopes to see both sides of this. If we are not representing the will of the institution, of the person, downstream of that, the consequences become extremely huge, extremely disastrous. Scripture tells us, if we are followers of Christ, we are ambassadors for Christ. We live for the will of God to be done here on earth. It's a huge statement. This is massive. Are you in Acts chapter 1? Let's look at the first chapter and now consider being witnesses of Christ. So I'm going to read this first section for us, the first 11 verses. You can follow along or just listen close. But this is beginning in verse 1 of Acts chapter 1. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. To them he presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up into heaven? This Jesus whom was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. That's the first 11 verses. This is a extremely important portion of Scripture. It gives us the Great Commission here in Acts. We have the Great Commission as well in the Gospel of Matthew. And so we kind of see this laid out. You are my witnesses, and you are to go and share about me. Some of you will know this, maybe not everyone, but some of you will. I enjoy photography. It's a hobby for me, and I really enjoy it. I enjoy seeing the photographs that others take. I enjoy watching YouTube videos about photography, learning more, and just all kinds of different aspects about photography. I really enjoy it. If you would like to engage in a very lively and entertaining conversation, I have a conversation starter for you, all right? So here's what you got to do. You have to gather a group of people who are interested in photography or just like to take photos and so forth, and here's the question that you ask. Here's the conversation starter. What makes a good photograph? What makes a good photograph? And I guarantee you, if you got several people who enjoy photography, you will have a very lively discussion around that, right? And then somewhere in there, you just kind of drop it in and you say, are there rules to follow to make a good photograph? Right? Are there rules? And I guarantee you'll find some people that say, oh, yes! And then you'll have some people, no. Right? And then just sit back and watch it all happen. I promise you, it's going to be interesting conversation, right? Now, I recently heard a photographer make this statement in regards to photography. He said this, we have to be conscious of our preferences. We have to be conscious of our preferences. And it really stood out to me as I was contemplating this passage in Acts chapter 1. Here's the connection. As I was thinking about these two different things, putting a sermon together and thinking about photography, and I hear this guy say this statement, we have to be conscious of our preferences. Here's how I changed the phrase a little bit. We have to be conscious of our definitions of words. We have to be conscious of our definitions of words. We have to be aware of how we define words. Right? Now, this has probably always been true, but right now we live in interesting times when it comes to words, and this is why we have to be aware. How we define a word is how we will live out that word. How we define a word is how we will live out that word. Few examples. The word danger, to some, means avoid it, be careful, don't touch, right? To others, the word danger means fun. Yes, absolutely. Let's do this. Well, it's going to be dangerous. That's why we're doing it, right? The word danger is going to mean something very different to different folks, right? The phrase, no trespassing, to some means under no circumstances do you enter. There is no circumstance at all, ever. No trespassing, you'd never go in there, right? To others, it means as long as I'm not caught, I can go in there, right? No one is around, so I can go in if I want to, right? No trespassing, danger. Some stay away. For others, I have to do it. No trespassing. To some, I'm not going in there. To others, you're making me go in there because you put the no trespassing sign on. Right? So really, it's your own fault, right? The phrase, caution, wet floor, to some means walk very carefully, very slowly, maybe walk around so that I don't leave my shoe print in the freshly mopped floor, right? To others, it begins an inner dialogue. Now, if I get a running start, how far can I slide down that aisle? Right? Okay. So when words and phrases, concepts and ideas, reality and hopes are left for us to define, we most often consult ourselves to see what makes the most sense in the moment we find ourselves. Let me say that again. When words and phrases, concepts and ideas, reality and hopes are left for us to define, we most often will consult ourselves to see what makes the most sense in the moment we find ourselves. Jesus doesn't leave open that possibility for his disciples. When I read this section in our present moment of time that we are living in, I find a word and phrase here very troubling, very problematic. And we have to focus in on it for a bit, all right? The phrase is, you will receive power. The word is power. In our present moment, right now, this is a difficult word because we can think of power as domination. And I'm going to give almost like playing charades. I'm going to show you something of that kind of shows how we think of power, right? For a lot of people, when it comes to power, this is the motion that we take on. You all got to look at me, right? Ready? This. Right? We flex. This is power. This is domination. If you want to see this symbol play, go and watch young men lift weights. Right? I stood in a lot of mirrors. Right? Like this. Oh, yeah, look at this. Right? This is power. This is domination. But Christ was the most powerful human ever to live, and he expressed it this way as he died. This is very different from this. Right? It's fine to do this, right? But is this what Christ is calling us to? Is this the power that he's calling us to? Telling us that we will receive. Let me rephrase this statement that's connected with the Greek. And if there's, if I end up getting any emails from Greek scholars that I've messed this all up, I'll come back and correct it later on, all right? But hear this from kind of what the Greek is kind of saying. Instead of you will receive power, you will be my witnesses with power. The Greek points us to this. You will be my martyrs with miraculous ability. You will be my martyrs with miraculous ability. See, in the present moment, power can lead us to one idea, and we can think this is what God is talking about. But then when we hear the words just phrased a little bit differently, it gives us a very different concept. You will be my martyrs with miraculous ability. A line from one of Chesterton's stories fits well here. I tell you this not for your comfort nor for your desire. What Jesus is saying here is very important. Let me kind of rephrase it here just to kind of get us really thinking about it. He's telling his disciples, and I think he's telling us as well, you won't know everything. And you don't need to know everything. The Father has authority and has determined everything. There is something for you to do, though. Right? You will receive miraculous ability and do great things, but not from yourself or your ability. The power will not be sourced from you. It is from God, the Holy Spirit. So go into all the world telling the story of me, the Savior of the world. You're not going to know everything. You're not going to be able to do everything from your own ability, from your own power. How can you do incredible things? Because of God, the Holy Spirit, leading you, directing you, helping you, doing things that you couldn't even fathom, right? And in that, you don't glory in yourself. We don't glory in ourselves. We glory in God. And being a witness is not just a matter of words, but is a matter of life. And I'm going to reference an example for us in all of this, and then leave it for you to study and read further, all right? So just a few chapters over, and if you want, you can start finding it. I will read one section for us in Acts chapter 7. It's just a few chapters over. we have this story of Stephen, right? Now, this is very fascinating and very challenging. So let me just give a quick summary. Stephen was chosen by the disciples to do some specific work in the beginning of the church. And here's how Stephen is described in chapter 6, verse 5. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. 6, 8. And Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people. 6:10, some people began to argue with Stephen, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit, capital S, with which he was speaking. They end up arresting him. And in 13 and 14, they're saying, this is how they describe Stephen. This man never stops talking negatively about our things and is always talking about Jesus. It's fantastic. He's never not talking negatively about our stuff, and he's always talking about this Jesus guy. We can't take it anymore. It's like they're just exasperated, right? We can't take it. Chapter 7 is fascinating. He's asked by the high priest, "Is this true? Is this true?" And Stephen gives this remarkable sermon. Right? Now, when you read this, I want you to keep in mind that his audience would have known everything that he is telling them. Right? They would have known this story very well. He's giving them a history lesson, and it's their own history. Right? So they would know this. It's not new information to them. Right? So he gives this sermon, and he's just sharing all of this history. And then we have the switch. The scripture is famous for this. You'll be going along, and then there'll be this switch. There'll be this thing that happens that you didn't see coming, right? And we have that in chapter 7, verses 51 through 53. So Stephen is going along, and he's talking to them. And then 51, he pulls a switch on them. Then here's his conclusion. "You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did not your fathers persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the laws delivered by angels and did not keep it." That's his conclusion, right? He's going on telling them this history, and then he concludes in this way that they would not have expected, right? It's a common and shared history, but he's saying you're living it out wrong. You're living this out incorrectly. Stephen is walking the same ground as these religious leaders. He's living in the same world, but he sees the history differently now because he is a follower of Jesus and is full of the Holy Spirit. Right? He tells a story they know, but concludes with something they didn't expect. We're told Stephen was full of power, full of the Holy Spirit. He does this amazing, amazing sermon, right? We can almost think of this conclusion leading to of Stephen walking out there to the other disciples, and they're all cheering. They throw him on their shoulders and march him out. "Yeah, you did it, man. Yeah, way to go. You really got them." That's not the conclusion. What happened to Stephen, full of power and of the Holy Spirit? They stoned him to death. They killed him. He was full of power, full of this amazing, incredible ability. And he lost his life. There was a father and daughter in a public garden, flowers and so forth. And they were enjoying taking it all in, looking at everything as you would imagine on the ground and so forth, and taking in all the different flower beds and all that kind of stuff. And there was no other families there or anybody at that time. And so they're there just enjoying it and so forth, and very quiet, very beautiful, beautiful day. And they look over across the lawn area into a flower bed, and they see a hummingbird, right? And they're watching this hummingbird, and because they've been able to see the hummingbird. They can watch its flight path. And all of a sudden, this tiny little hummingbird flies straight up into the upper canopy of the trees hanging over the flower garden, and it just sits down on one of the branches, right? Now, this is a tiny little hummingbird inside of this huge canopy of trees, and if you just look up into it, you're not going to be able to see anything. But because they had watched it, they were able to see where it had landed, and they're just watching this hummingbird up in this treetop. And so they're there and they're excitedly talking about it. They're enjoying this hummingbird tremendously, right? And as they're there and they're looking up in this kind of unexpected direction in the flower garden, this other family arrived. And they're walking in and they're looking at the flowers and taking it all in and so forth. And the husband of the family just continues to walk closer and closer and closer. And he's watching the father and daughter as they are not looking down, but instead looking up, right? And they're pointing and they're taking this in and they're trying to get photos and all this kind of stuff. And they're just tuned in to this thing. And he kept doing the typical, like, looking, right? Like, what? Well, what are they seeing that I can't see? There's something up there. I can't see it. Like, what is it? And he kept getting, this was pre-COVID. He kept getting closer and closer and closer, right? And he finally comes up and he says, "You're driving me crazy. Like, I have to know. What are you looking at? What is up there?" Right? Because you're looking up there when I would expect you to be looking down here. What is up there? What are you seeing? And the father and the daughter turn to the man excitedly. There's a hummingbird up there. It's a beautiful hummingbird. And the man goes, Oh, okay. And walked away. Not excited in any way. Right? He couldn't see it. He didn't watch it fly around or anything. And when he heard what it was, it didn't meet his expectation. And he did not have the same response as the father and the daughter. As witnesses of Christ, we will be walking the same ground, but see things that others don't. And if given the chance, then try to align the reality of the up there with the reality of the down here. The response is up to those who hear. We cannot force a response. The father and daughter wanted to grab that other guy and say, "Revel in this hummingbird. What is wrong with you? This hummingbird is amazing." But instead, he just walked away, and they had to just let him walk away. Right? As witnesses, we try to align the two realities and say, God is here. God is alive. God is working. I've seen it. I know it. Here's the truth. But I can't force you. I leave it with you to consider Jesus. Now, please hear this, all right? Be very sparing with insulting conclusions like Stephen's. Okay? Be very careful with doing that. It fit in the moment for Stephen to do that, to end that way. It that doesn't give us license to just insult everybody, okay? So be sparing with those. And definitely never say, "Well, my pastor told me I could insult you if I needed to." That's not true. All right. Three pathways and a closing word of Scripture. These pathways are not mine, and I'm not expounding on them. I'm giving them to us to just plug into, to add into your thought processes as you're reading, as you're thinking, as you're living out, being a witness, being an ambassador, All right, so these are from my reading this week. I'm working through these, I'm thinking through these, and I want to share them with you. As witnesses, as ambassadors, as we walk down pathways in life, there's three pathways that are important for us as witnesses, followers of Jesus. The first path is mercy and the work of justice. The second pathway is beauty, and the third pathway is evangelism. Now, I fully understand giving these pathways is like kicking a hornet's nest because it comes down to words and how we define and understand words. The same way that power has become a difficult word, the word justice has become a difficult word. I have a long history of kicking hornet's nests, so I'm doing it again this morning, right? It's not what the culture says justice means. What does God mean by justice? How does God understand justice? Beauty, same. As witnesses, as ambassadors, are we engaging with beauty? Are we sharing beauty? Are we being beautiful? What does beauty look like? And even the third, evangelism. This is a difficult word in this present moment that we live in. But I think they're worthwhile for us to think through. Mercy and the work of justice, beauty and evangelism, three important pathways. Here's the closing scripture for us this morning, Hebrews 12:1-2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, you have given us this role, these roles as ambassadors, as witnesses. It is humbling, it is precious, it is terrifying. Father, help us to never try to define any of this apart from you. Help us to never try to do any of this apart from you. Lord, you want your will done. Because you know how glorious it is, how much better it is than anything that we could ever come up with. Father, help us to just be so endeared to you, to love you so much that we wouldn't even dream of trying to place our will above yours. Father, help us because you seem to make it clear as though this is not really a choice. We are your witnesses. We are your ambassadors if we are followers of you. And so help us because it's something that we want to do well and we want to do correctly. Father, as we close, we're just thinking about Plymouth State, all the faculty and staff and students. Protect everybody as they're making their way in, as classes begin, as all the different procedures and everything are started up again. Protect Plymouth State. Help them to just have a great, great semester. And may it be a story of success. Father, help us. We all live in different surrounding communities. Help us to be safe, to be well, but also to be your witnesses and ambassadors wherever we call home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand? We're going to close with a final song.
Thinking about Dennis's words about power and what it actually means to have the power of the Holy Spirit, I just want us to be thinking and meditating on the concept of God's power, Christ's power, being made perfect in our weakness. So let's go before the Lord, acknowledging that we need him. Thank you. Let's hear from Hebrews 12 one last time. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Thank you for being with us this morning in person and in the live stream. I pray that you guys have a great week. Go in peace, friends.